it's time to give up. I have to admit that I am one of those people that thinks the dishwasher is a miracle. There are two ways to split logs for a fire. One is the character building way, as countless fathers have told their sons, which is swinging an axe over your head until your arms fall off, slowly accumulating a small pile. It's exhausting and back-breaking. The other is by using a motorized log splitter. You can do it 4 or 5 times faster and save yourself a lot of effort. We forget that we have access to an amazing power in Christ through the Holy Spirit. It's miraculous, I dare say. Easily the difference between an axe and a log splitter. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than this, because I am going to the Father. Think about this. This is not the time to try to explain away the clear meaning of his words. Jesus promises us that through the power of the Holy Spirit, we will be able to do anything and everything that the Father wants to accomplish through us. It's not up to us to gird our loins and get her done. The key is to allow the power of the Spirit to do it through us. If you are tired of swinging an axe for God, working your hardest for Him, and if you think you've already built enough character this way, it's time to give up. Quite frankly, He doesn't need your help anyway. Faith in Jesus opens up a new way of living, where we are empowered by His Spirit in us as we allow Him to work through us. Lord Jesus, I believe that I have access to amazing power through your Spirit within me. I am tired of trying to do this in my own strength for you. I want to be used for your glory, but I want to do so in your strength through me alone. Thanks. Hallelujah. Amen. If Christ was dependent on God, why shouldn't we be? Let your religion be less of a theory and more of a love affair. When my kids were little, they were totally dependent on me for everything. Food, shelter, love, all of it. They could not nothing without my provision. When we think of dependent people, Jesus probably isn't even on the list, but he was. Big time. The granddaddy of all the passages that teach that Jesus was dependent on the Father during his time on earth is John 14. It's a beautiful picture of the dependence of a son on his father, of the son of the father, showing the intimacy Jesus and the Father share, an intimacy he invites us into. In verse 6, we get a glimpse of something deeper. Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him, and we have seen him. Christ in our only accept to the Father. By knowing Christ, we get to know the Father. Jesus was teaching his disciples that they shouldn't just look to him to get stuff, because there is no other way or no other path to the presence of God. It's easy to lose track of why we worship. We tend to want to to worship Jesus because of the stuff we think he will give us in return. It doesn't work that way. He offers us not only salvation, but the Father. It's that simple, and it's enough. God, I praise you that you offer so much more than simple provision. You offer us access to you through humble dependence. That is enough, Father. You are enough for me. Hallelujah, amen, hallelujah, amen. Praise Jesus and God, hallelujah, amen. A new way to live. You can safely assume that you have created God in your own image when it turns out that God hates all the same people you do. Remember back in school how there was always one kid who asked the question that everyone was thinking, but everyone was too scared to ask because it sounded dumb. And remember how grateful you were for that person. Well, the disciples were no different, and Philip was that kid. Jesus had just told the disciples something truly amazing in John 14, part 6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. It was a stunning truth, a paradigm shift in all of their brains. But Philip pipes up and says, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough for us. You can almost hear the frustration in Jesus' voice in his response. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. We similarly miss the message once in a while. We see Christ do amazing things in lives all around us, and yet we still tend to miss the point or fail to see the implications of this mystery. Jesus is the revelation of the Father to us. When we see the Son, we see the Father too, a supernatural unity with Jesus in the Father and the Father in Jesus. The point is that we have become sons and daughters of the Father too. When we get to know Jesus, we get to know the Father as well. We have been adopted into the family where we share in the intimacy and fellowship of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's not just theology. Jesus modeled a dependency on the Father over and over, showing us a new way to live today. Dear God, stun me with the reality of your truth. Touch my soul with the spiritual reality that the Son is in the Father is in Son, and that through Jesus only I can come to the Father in the same way. I praise you and thank you for what you have done. I bow in awe and worship you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Heavenly Father God, send your lovely, happy, successful glory to our Jesus, that he can make a glory and send it to us, and we can make a glory sent back to both of you. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Turning your affections toward God. The hunger of love is much more difficult to remove than the hunger of bread. Major Ian Thomas wrote about something he called the three-hold interlock. Sure, it sounds like a wrestling move, but what he was describing is how we live a life of faith. We love God. That love of God leads to dependency on God. Dependency on God results in obedience to God. That's good stuff, but it's not the whole story. Love doesn't start with us. Our love for God could never originate from our own hearts. And unlike a lot of love we experience on earth, God doesn't love us because we love Him first. That's actually backwards. We love God for a very specific reason. We love Him because He first loved us. Our love for Christ comes in response to His amazing love for us. I don't think we can actually wrap our minds around how much He loves us. He died on the cross for us. He knows about all of our wicked sin, and yet He still loves us and accepts us. When you truly recognize that kind of love for what it is, and this the Spirit shows it to you, you will find yourself enraptured with love for Him. It's not something that you have to manufacture on your own. Just give it some true thoughts. Pray it thoughts. Ask God to make you willing to see, feel, taste, hear His love with all your senses. Close your eyes. Vividly imagine you are in the crowd that day the Son of God bled and died. Our beloved Lord Jesus, Your love for me is deep and powerful, and I really can't comprehend it. It just embrace it. Help me to see it, Spirit, and turn my affections toward You. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. How you get the power to do all things. A journey is like marriage. The certain way to be wrong is to think you control it. When I first began a relationship with my wife, I wasn't dependent on her. We fell deeper in love. We got married. We made a commitment to become dependent on one another, and over time it became more and more natural to become dependent on one another. This is from Pastor Pete Briscoe, this article. Hallelujah. Love is the motive we have for not only getting married but also becoming dependent on Christ. True love is like that. It draws us together in a way that makes separation and independence seem impossible. Through our love for Him, we become dependent on Him. So we immerse ourselves in His unconditional love, allowing Him to accept us just the way we are. A new strength is found within. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all this through Jesus, Him who gives me strength. Being dependent on Christ is how we get power to do all things. We are equipped for His service by being attached to Him, relying on Him for everything. What a relief. It is not up to us. Beloved Lord Jesus, thank you for being my source. May your love become a real, so real that it just naturally overflows, moving me to do all things through you who gives me strength. Thank you for empowering me through your love for my tasks to the glory of your name. Hallelujah, amen, hallelujah, amen. The key to joyful obedience. A boy can learn a lot from a dog. Obedience, loyalty, and the importance of turning around 3 times before lying down. Being loved and empowered by God leads us into obedience to whatever He asks for of us. We don't just begrudgingly submit to His commands like He is some far off tyrant. We don't have to obey to earn His favor or acceptance, or be fearful or tentative when our efforts fall short. That's not the way He designed it to work. It's actually joyful. And this is love, that we walk in obedience to His commands. As you have heard from the beginning, His command is that you walk in love. In our human terms, we don't normally equate love with obedience, but that's just how God set it up. Since He loves us so much, we are hardwired to return that love by joyfully obeying Him. We know where true joy is, not in quick fix earthly stuff, but in a steady relationship with Christ. If we have experienced His unconditional love, we will love Him back. And if we love Him, we will naturally follow His lead. Father, I yearn to walk in obedience, but it gets tough when I look at you as some sort of killjoy. I resist when I feel like I have to perform to earn your love. Show me with an experience of your unconditional true love. May that love empower me to serve in heartfelt joy. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Go where grace is leading you. Grace goes the distance. God's grace led Jesus on a journey for the ages. He descended from the halls of heavens, took on flesh as a baby in Bethlehem, and returned in glory to His heavenly throne, conquering every power of evil in the process. In grace, He went the distance. The Bible shows how God's grace empowers you to follow Jesus just as far. By faith, you can answer the call of Christ in your life, making His name known in your family, in your city, and to the ends of the earth. It's designed to acquaint you with the will and word of God. Put it into practice. Scripture describes God's macro plan for the created order, and it also describes God's micro plans for individual followers of Jesus. But what about you specifically? How do you take the God's word says and put His will into personal practice? God's love moves you. It is for each of us freely to choose whom we shall serve, and find in that obedience our freedom. As eager as we can be to obey God, leaping in too quickly is also a problem. In modern evangelism, we can occasionally skip over love and empowerment, the necessary first two steps, and dive right into action. Without the motive of love or the power of dependence on Christ, we blast away and cause damage. Because of the service by which you have proved yourselves, others will praise God for the obedience that accompanies your confession of the gospel of Christ and for your generosity in sharing with them and with everyone else. You can see what obedience done right looks like. Others will see it and praise God. Apart from a heart that is truly learning to love God, we will have no motivation for obedience other than the abject fear of punishment, a lack of understanding of love and dependency always leads to legalism. Is obedience important? Yes. Do we produce it out of the flesh? No. Our love for Him yielded to Him as He lives within us, in where we should find ourselves walking in obedience. Holy Spirit, give me the proper perspective on being obedient to you. I don't want to jump in too quickly, nor do I want to miss it if you are nudging me. Teach me and guide me. Break me if needed to strengthen my dependence. I stand ready to let your love move me today and every day. Hallelujah, amen. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Hallelujah, amen.